working really hard, working with the amazing Kakuzuki puppets that you've seen displayed in the library on the wall. This is actually the first time we're using the puppets, though, so we're really excited. These girls have worked hard writing an original script, and then also, of course, rehearsing. So they wrote three separate little plays. The first one is called Dinner with Mr. and Mrs. Moose. And in the first play, Simon, Paul, and Tig learn an important lesson about manners. Because as you know, when you go to somebody's house for dinner, or when you go out to a restaurant to eat, or even when you're eating at home with your family, it's important to remember your manners, right? Can you think of an important dinner or table manner? One that you use, Robert? Say excuse me after you burp. That's a good one. What else? Yes, learn.
Don't throw food at people.
Good one. Never. Another table manner. Yes, Evan. Oh, sorry, honey. Library manners, table manners, what else?
Sorry.
you're sorry. That's a good one. Thank you for sharing that. What else? How about classroom manners when you're in school? How are you supposed to behave in school? Yes. Yes, you should always walk in the hall. No running in the hallway. What else? Raise your hand is a very important classroom manner. Yes. What else? Be good listeners when the teacher's talking. Don't ignore the teacher. Definitely. Good advice when she's talking. Yes. When else? Yes. Always do what the teacher asks you to do. Very good. In the back again.
Lesson to
lion learn? Claire.
They can meet other people and they won't want to be nice to you.
Right, so you should always remember that golden rule, right? Treat others the way we want to be treated. Always, always be kind, because you never know when you're going to be stuck, when you're going to need help, right? And you want others to help you. Yeah. If you were a flower, would you help Lion? Yes? Raise your hand if you would have. Good. Okay. Robert, you wanted to say something before you had your hand up. Do you remember what it was? Right, he has to remember not to be rude. And I think he learned that lesson, right? I think from now on, Lion's not going to be rude. He's going to treat others nicely. Very good. Yes?
My question is, this is going to be a pretty good question.
Okay, let's hear it.
Stop and sing and sing.
What? Oh, don't get stuck in quicksand. That's really good advice. You're full of good advice tonight. Great job. Sinking sands. Yes, of course. All right, as they change into their costumes for the final play, guys, I just want to remind you that these puppets are from Cheryl Capizzuti, who works out of Brighton Heights. She's been a puppet maker for 20-some years. She's commissioned for a lot of work, but she does a lot of it just because it's fun, and she volunteers to do it. When we went to pick up these puppets at her house, it was kind of neat because she pulled up her garage door, and she literally had 200 puppets stacked, one on top of the other. So she just couldn't house them anymore, and that's why she approached libraries, and we are one of three in Allegheny County to have these puppets with us. So it's pretty exciting. They're all made out of recycled materials, cardboard, and paper, for the most part. From far away, they look painted, don't they? But it's all colored paper. Okay, so it's pretty neat, and if you're interested in how she made them, and if you'd like to be a part of that hands-on puppet making, we're actually doing a workshop on August 21st. So mark that date on your calendar. If you're around, we'd love for you to help us make a puppet. And we'll all work on one together. Okay? All right, Teen Puppet Trip's very last performance of the evening is called Moontown. And in this story, a new boy is in town. And because he's new, he doesn't know anybody. So he feels very lonely. And he looks different than everybody else. So he also feels a little bit left out. Have you ever felt that way? I think we all have, in one situation or another, felt lonely or felt left out. So we're going to see what lessons we can learn in the final play called Moontown.
In a town called Moontown, everyone knows that Auntie the Bluebird and Garfield the Blue Cat are in the Blue Cliff, which left out everyone else. And Judy the Pink Bunny and Roberto the Pink Daisy are in the Pink Cliff, which also left out everyone else. One school day, Johnny the Multicolored Boy moved into Moontown. Since Johnny was neither blue nor pink, he didn't know who to be friends with. When he walked down the hallway, he noticed that everyone would laugh and stare at his multicolored face. At lunch on his first day of school, Johnny entered the lunchroom. He grabbed his share of food, then wondered where he would sit. He looked around the room and saw a girl named Unigua, the River Queen, sitting all alone. Johnny decided to go and sit with her.
Hi, what's your name?
My name's Johnny. What's your name?
Unigua.
That's unique.
From that day on, Unigua and Johnny became best friends. They thought about making their own multicolored clique, but knew that it was wrong to leave people out. One day, the pink clique, the blue clique, Unigua, and Johnny were asked to do a project together.
Ew, I don't want to work with them.
Me neither.
Well, I don't want to work with them either. Yeah.
Well, as long as we have to work on this project together, we might as well get to know each other.
I like to sing as loud as the ocean tide as it crashes against the sand.
Me too. I love to sing.
And I like to recite my poems as I dance the song of my country.
I like poems.
I like to dance like the wind as it blows the leaves on the trees.
I love to dance.
See, we aren't really that different. We just look different. But that's okay, because we don't all have to look the same to get along.
Nancy, Garfield, Judy, Roberto, Johnny, and Unigua all learned a very good lesson that day. We don't all have to look the same to get along. The only thing that matters is what's inside. The end.
Make new friends, the TTO.
dress the same as us? Absolutely. We can be friends with everybody. We can all be friends. All right, I know you can't see their faces, but I'd like to introduce our puppet troupe. So when you girls hear your name, just give a little wave. We have Delaney Lacey. Autumn Lair. Minute. These girls stepped up, so thank you again.
Yeah, my pleasure to introduce to you storyteller extraordinaire, Mr. Tim Hartman.
Hi. My name is Tim Hartman. I'm a storyteller for the Pittsburgh Children's Museum. How many of you have ever been down to the Pittsburgh Children's Museum? Cool. Okay, hands down. When I tell stories, I have two rules. And they're very simple rules. If you guys can handle these rules, I'm going to turn you down to the level. If you guys can follow these rules, we're going to have a great time. Rule number one, it is my time to talk. So that means I need you guys to be as quiet as you can while I tell the story. But I know things happen. You might see something in the show you like. Or you might see something in the show you hate. Or you might see something in the show you don't understand. Or you just might turn to the person next to you and say something like, that big guy sweating like a pig, look at that. And okay, I know stuff like that happens. But if it gets so noisy that I can't hear, and you can't hear, well, what's the use in telling anybody's story? So, if things get a little noisy, I will simply raise my hand. And when I raise my hand, that means please just get as quiet as fast as you can, so I can keep the story going. Is that okay?
Yeah!
Good! I'm still gonna turn this down, it's too loud still. Wait a minute. The second rule is this. This is what's called a participation program. And in a participation program, that means that some of you will be able to come up here and help me do what I do. But there's a rule that goes along with that as well. I'll say something like, boy, I could really use some help out here. Who would like to help me? If you want to help me, what are you going to do? Hands down. This is where the trouble starts, because I know there's some people who really want to help. And so instead of just sitting there nicely like this, some people do this. King of the forest! No. Any other suggestions?
suggestions? Yes, ma'am.
A monkey.
A monkey! No, not the monkey. What do you think?
An elephant.
An elephant! Excuse me. No! What do you think it is? A cat! No! Way up here, yes ma'am. A chicken! No! All right, hands down, mouths closed. The animal that was admired above all other animals was the crab. Yeah, I know. You're thinking to yourself, crab? What do you mean, crab? The crab's like a bug crab, for sakes. The crab has got those little skinny legs. The crab has those eyeballs that move independently. A crab, it looks like a bug crab, for sakes. If you see a crab walking at you, you go, ooh! It's still wiggling. But you see, the crab had a talent that no other animal had. The crab could do something that no other animal could. The crab would stand on the beach all day and he'd warm up a little bit. And he'd say in this little crabby voice, little eyes, fly out over the ocean. And right away, his little crabby eyes would pop off his head and fly out over the ocean. Yeah, what are you saying to yourself? Hey, that's weird. But let me put this in perspective. I know every night an adult looks at you. I don't know, maybe 8 o'clock, maybe 9 o'clock, maybe even at 10 o'clock. A parent will look at you and say, go to bed. Go up to your room, get into your bed, turn off the light, do not move, do not think, do not breathe. Go to bed. Oh my gosh, it's so boring. It's dark, and you're not that tired, and you know your parents are downstairs having a good time, right? Maybe they're watching a DVD, or maybe they made some popcorn, or maybe they ordered out for pizza, or maybe they're even kissing. I know, disgusting. But wouldn't it be really interesting if while you were laying in bed, you could pop out your eyeballs, throw them down on the floor, flop, flop. Have them roll across the floor, flop, 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 flop. Have them roll down the steps, flop, 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 flop. Have them roll across the floor, flop, flop, flop. And look around the corner in the living room. You see, even though your eyes were attached to your body, you could still see through your eyes. That would be so fantastic! until your parents saw eyeballs on the floor, right? Ew. And then that would just be messy. Well, that's the way it was for the crab. Even though his eyes weren't attached to his body, he could still see through his eyes. And so he could make his eyes do things in the air. He could make his eyes do figure eights. He could make his eyes go around in circles. He looked up at the sky, at the birds, at the clouds. He looked up at the waves, at the fish, at the boats. And when he finally got bored, he'd say, little eyes, come back to me. Right away, his eyeballs would pop back into his crabby head. All the other animals saw him doing this, and they said to themselves, cool. And one day the jaguar was walking along the beach. The jaguar saw the crab doing this, and the jaguar said, excuse me, Mr. Crab, but I would like you to make my eyes fly out of the ocean. The crab said, okay. Number one, it's dangerous because your eyeballs have to pop out of your head. And number two, if you let your eyes fly too close to the water, there's a fish in the ocean called the Okaloka fish, and he likes to jump up and try to eat up your eyeballs. So I'm really sorry, but I can't let you do it. The jaguar said, no. Oh, I'm sorry, I really haven't made myself clear. You see, if you don't do this, I'm afraid I'm going to have to eat you. The little crab said, okay. And
So the little crab began to warm up. And he said in his little crabby voice, jaguar eyes, fly out over the ocean. And right away, the jaguar felt this pulling at the front of his face. And his eyeballs popped out of his head. The jaguar said, wait, what do I do now? And the little crab said, well, imagine your eyes flying across the ocean. And so right away he did, and it was amazing. He and his eyes do figure eights. He and his eyes go around in circles. Look at the sky, the birds, the clouds, look down at the waves, and the fish, and the boats. And when he finally got bored, he said, now, Mr. Crab, bring my eyeballs back. The crab said, yeah, but remember, don't let your eyes fly too close to the water, or the okaloka fish will jump up and, your eyeballs. Just do it, said the jaguar. And so the little crab said, jaguar eyes, come back to him, and right away, his eyeballs popped back into his jaguar head. The jaguar said, that was fun. The jaguar said, do that again. The little crab said, no. Too dangerous. One per customer, not gonna do it. Not got that. The jaguar said, no. I'm sorry, I haven't made myself clear. You see, if you don't do this, I'm afraid I'm going to have to eat you. The little crab said, okay. And so one last time. Jaguar eyes, fly out of the ocean. Unfortunately, jaguar let his eyes fly too close to the water. And the last thing he remembered seeing were four rows of sharp little yellow teeth, a long pink tongue, and everything went dark. At first, the jaguar didn't quite know what was going on. Excuse me, Mr. Crab. Excuse me, I don't know what's going on. Stop it. buzzard walked over to the jaguar. He looked down at him. And he said, "What's your problem?" And the jaguar said, "I don't have eyeballs." The buzzard, he sat down. He began to think for a little bit. And after he thought for a little bit, he said, "I'll tell you what. If I were to get you some eyeballs, would you do something for me?" The jaguar said, "Anything. I just want some eyeballs." And so the buzzard flew up. He flew up over the mountaintops and down over the valleys and waterfalls, looking high and looking low for eyeballs. But do you think eyeballs are easy things to find? No. If you have eyeballs sitting around your house somewhere, I'm not coming over. But he did find something to help him. The buzzard found a blueberry. And the blueberries were ripe and plump and juicy. And he plucked two of the ripest, plumpest, juiciest blueberries off that blueberry bush. He flew back to the beach. He landed in the sand. He walked over to the jaguar. He looked down at him. And he passed them the blueberries. The jaguar took those blueberries in his paws. He shoved them in his eye holes. He shook his jaguar head. He blinked his jaguar eyelid. And he said, "I can see. I can see. Oh, baby. Oh, baby. I can see. Now, what can I do for you, Mr. Buzzard?" The buzzard said, "I'll tell you what, buzzards, we have a personal problem. Our beaks are very brittle. And when it makes it hard to eat, you bite into something hard and our beaks will just pop right off. So I'll tell you what, whenever you kill an animal to eat it, if you could just leave a little meat on the bones for us buzzards to eat, we would appreciate that." The jaguar said, "All right." And the buzzard flew off. The jaguar spent the rest of that day into the evening looking for that stinking little crab, but he never found it. And from that day till now, whenever a jaguar kills something to eat it, he always leaves a little meat on the bones for the buzzards to eat. And from that day till now, if you go to the beach and try to catch those little crabs, you're going to have a hard time because they think that you're the jaguar out to get him for having his eyeballs eaten up by the Oonka Loonka fish. The end. So, is that the most ridiculous story you've ever heard in your life?
No.
Pretty ridiculous. And when I was a little boy and I first read that story, I said to myself, "What? Where did that come from? That just makes no sense. Eyeballs. Eaten by a fish. Where did they come up with that idea?" Well, let me tell you. This story was written by Native Americans in South America. You can imagine a couple of Native Americans sitting around one day. One Native American says to the other Native American, "Whoa, check this out, Ernie." Ernie, the Native American. "Hey, Ernie, look at that. That jaguar just left food for the buzzards to eat. I mean, he goes to see the buzzards. Why do you think he does that, Ernie?" And Ernie says, "I don't know." "And whoa, check this out, Ernie. The little crabs are running away from the kids. I mean, but why are they scared? They got those pinchy things. What are they so scared about?" "What do you think, Ernie?" And Ernie says, "I don't know." And so they tried to answer their questions about things that happen in their world around them with this story. Is this story true?
No.
No, it's not true. But is it a good story?
Yes.
Would you like me to tell you another story?
Yes.
This is a true story. And to tell this story, I need someone to play the main character because I can't play the main character myself. Yeah, so there's a young man with a bicycle on his shirt. It's orange and white. Come up here, young man. Let's give him a hand for helping me out. Excellent.
What is your name? Hi, Lenny. I'm Tim. Good to meet you, Lenny. Lenny, you're kind of floppy. That's okay. You know why I picked you? Because you're fuzzy. Okay, so I'm going to tell you who you're going to play. You stand right there. This is a story that took place 2,000 years ago in the deserts of Egypt. And you are a guy named Macarius. You handle it? Macarius. It's an old-fashioned name. There's some things you have to know about him. Macarius is very, 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 very old. Yeah, so you kind of have to be old. What does an old guy look like? What do you do? Oh my gosh! There's an old guy with some problems right there. You need more calcium in your diet. That's what I think. Okay, that's good. And you can talk a little too, so you're no, that's good, that's old, that's good. Now, one more thing you have to know is Macarius had a nickname. Because he was so old, everybody called him Macarius the Elder. And so whenever I say your name, Macarius the Elder, you have to say something. As loud as you can so everybody can hear you, you have to say, yummy! Do it again for you. Yummy! So go ahead and try for me. Yummy. Yeah! Let's do it! Give him a big round of applause. That was awesome, right? So, let's practice. I'll say your name, then you do it. Ready? Here we go. Macarius the Elder. Oh, you are the creepiest old man I've ever seen. That's awesome. Okay, so, ladies and gentlemen, this is how the story goes. I'm going to give you a microphone so everybody can hear it. You ready? Here we go. Once upon a time, a long, long time ago, somebody brought a lovely basket of grapes to Macarius the Elder.
Ooh, yeah, me?
But you see, Macarius was a good guy. And even though he could use the grapes himself, he thought of somebody else that could use the grapes even more than he could. He thought of his friend, Simon. And I need someone to play Simon because I'm playing an Everett Raider. I can't play Simon, so I need someone who is Simon-like. There's a young man in a red shirt right here, Mikey Red Shirt. Come here, Mikey Red Shirt man. Come and help me. Stand right here, Mikey Red Shirt dude. Do you know him? You know him? You like him okay? He's not sure. It's okay. It's okay. That's right. You guys are friends now. And, over here. Hi. What's your name? Hi, Isaac. Nice to meet you, Isaac. Isaac, you're not Isaac anymore. Now you're Simon. And Simon has a nickname just like this guy. Simon has a nickname that has to do with the fact that he doesn't feel very good. Everybody called him Simon the Sickly. Yeah. And so every time I say your name, Simon Sickly, you have to make a noise too. You can go, no, don't do that. Every time I say Simon Sickly, I want you to go, this is going to be great. I want you to go, are you excited? I think this is going to be great. You want to practice? Practice. Here we go. Here we go. Simon the Sickly. That's disgusting. Alright, here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Let's try. Once upon a time, a long time ago, somebody brought some grapes to Macarius the Elder.
Ooh, yeah, me.
Who in turn gave to his friend Simon the Sickly? You have corn. And wait a minute, Simon had a friend. Simon had another friend. He could keep the grapes, but he thought of his friend, John. Don't worry, girls, I'm getting to you. John. Even someone played John. 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 They are white-teeth, white-shirt with a tan on. Come up here. Are you related to him? Oh, no, don't tell anybody. Nepotism. Right here, sir. Right here. Do you know him?
Yeah.
No, you don't. You don't know him. You don't know him. Okay. What's your name? What is it?
Ewan.
Ewan, nice to meet you, man. It's a good name. But you are not. You now have a new name. And your new name is, you know, his name's Simon and his name's Vicarious. Your name is John. Okay? And John, he's got a nickname too. His nickname has to do with the fact that he eats too much sugar. And so about dinner time every night, John gets a little jumpy. And so his name was John the Jumpy. And every time I say I'm John the Jumpy, you have to do this. You have to go. Can you handle it? Here we go. Let's try it. John the Jumpy. John the Jumpy. The big John the Jumpy. No, that was ready to fall down her. That's good. That's good. Okay, here we go. Just don't hurt yourself. Here we go. Once upon a time, somebody gets a great shoe and carries the elder.
Yeah, me.
I'm going to have nightmares about you tonight, okay? Who gave his friend Simon the Sickly?
You!
Just barked on that lady. Who turned in his friend John the Tubby? Jumpy, 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 but wait a minute, John had a friend! A friend whose name was Betty. I told you I'd get your girls. I told you I'd get your girls. There's a young lady, she's got a shirt on that is purple, lilac, and white, and black. Come up here. That's perfect. That's absolutely perfect. You know her?
No.
Okay, good. No, you're not used to her. Hi!
Hello.
What's your name? Hi, Randy. Nice to meet you, Randy. Randy, you're not Randy anymore. No. Then go with it! Okay. Randy? That's good. Randy, you are now Betty. Yeah, and Betty has a nickname like everybody else. Betty has a nickname because she's a little gassy. But no, I mean, everybody called her Betty the Belcher. And no, right now you're thinking to yourself, oh my God. But don't worry, yeah. Because I don't want you to bet, you don't have to do that. What I want you to do, every time I say Betty the Belcher, you turn to the audience, give them some attitude. Yeah, attitude. And once you do the attitude, you go, burr. Got it? Attitude. Try it. Here we go. Shh. Betty the Belcher. Okay, here we go. Once upon a time, somebody gave some grapes to Macarius the Elder.
Ooh, yeah.
Oh, you're getting creepier and creepier. Who in turn gave his friend Simon the Sickly? Who in turn gave his friend John the Tubby? Jumpy, 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 jumpy. Jumpy, jumpy, jumpy. Who in turn? Jumpy! Who in turn gave his friend Ben the Bouncer? Tim. Hi, Lynn. Lynn and Tim. So, Lynn, you're not Lynn anymore. Now you're Stephanie, and Stephanie has a nickname like everybody else. Stephanie, her nickname is Stephanie the Stinky. Don't worry. You don't have to do anything. You just stand there and stink. It's the rest of us who get to do this. Every time I say Stephanie the Stinky, everybody in the room, we all say, be. Which stands for body odor. It's all right. We're not judging. Not judging. So let's practice. I'm going to say it. Stephanie the Stinky. We'll all say it at the same time. Be. You ready? Stephanie the Stinky.
Be.
Here we go! Ready to tell the story again? Once upon a time, somebody gave some credits to Macarius the Elder. Don't push too hard, okay? Who in turn gave his friend Simon the Sibley? Who in turn gave his friend John the Dummy? Who in turn gave to Ben the Mountain? Who in turn gave to Stephanie the Stinky?
Thank
you. But wait a minute! She has a friend. I need someone to help me again. I'm going to pick an adult human again. I'm really sorry. When the teacher says, does anybody know the answer? And all the adults go. And this is who I want.
Nate?
Yeah. Get him up here. Thanks so much for helping. It's very nice of you. What's your name? Hi, Lenny. Nice to meet you, Lenny. That's two Lennies, right? Okay, but you're not Lenny anymore. Now you are, you're Harold. And Harold has a backstory. When Harold was just a little boy, he was attacked by a gaggle of geese. And from that moment on, everybody called him Harold the Honker. And so every time you say your name, Harold the Honker, you make little wings, and you see your little wings. That's awesome. And then you really bear down on this, okay? Really bear down. And you go, HALT! As loud as you can. Okay, we'll surprise everybody, okay? So remember, Harold the Honker, wings, and HALT! This is going to be awesome. Here we go. Once upon a time, somebody gave some grades to Macarius the Elder. Too much cheese, I think. Who in turn gave to his friend Simon the Sibley? Who in turn gave to John the Tempe? Who in turn gave to Tempe? Who in turn gave to Ben the Belcher?
Would you be Milo?
Pinkie Pie. You like that? Yeah, okay. Give him a big hand for helping. All right, so what's your name?
Jeff.
Hi, Jeff. Nice to meet you, Jeff. Jeff, you are now Milo. And Milo has a nickname just like everybody else. Milo's nickname is Milo the Monkey Boy. And so you know what we want to see. We want to see. You want to pick bumps out of her hair, you just go right ahead. Anything you want to do, the mic is good. Just surprise us, okay? Here we go. Everyone, last time I'm going to do this. Once upon a time, somebody gave some grapes to Macarius the Elder. Who in turn gave to his friend Simon the Sickly? There's the pizza. Who in turn gave to John the Jumpy? Who in turn gave to... Who turned into Stubby the Stinky? Who turned into Harold the Hunker? Well, what the name? Who turned into Milo the Monkey Boy?
Straight. Hands in your lap.
close your mouths. Don't hear anybody talking. Close your eyes. And everybody in the room, we're going to use our imagination. I want you to imagine that you're standing on the beach. Oh, yeah. Right by the ocean, you can feel the sun shining down on your face. And then maybe you start to sweat a little bit, but there's a breeze blowing, and it dries up your sweat right away. You're not standing on the hot sand. You're standing on the wet sand, so you can feel the sand kind of squishing through your toes. There are sounds that you can hear. You can hear the waves lapping up on the shore, one after another. You can hear the wind blow. There's an old seagull flying over top of you. He's screeching because he thinks maybe you have some food for him. Now, in your imagination, nobody move. Just in your head, you turn around, and behind you is a fishing village. Just a bunch of ramshackle old houses. And the funny thing is that each house is up on stilts, so that when the waves come in high at high tide, they can't knock over the houses. The houses are kind of old. They were painted at one time, and a lot of the paint is peeled off, and you can see that the wood underneath has been stained gray by the sea spray. Now, to your right is a bay. And in that bay are boats, beautifully taken care of, all different colors, reds and greens and yellows and blues. Each boat has a mast. Each mast has a sail. You can open up your eyes now. You are in a fishing village. 300 years ago, on the coast of Japan, and the people who lived in that fishing village, they loved the ocean. Well, for the same reason that you and I love the ocean, right? We can do the ocean. We're swimming, you can find seashells or sea stars, and you can pick them up and toss them to the waves. But as much as the kids love the ocean, the old people love the ocean too. Because every day they go out on their boats, and they go catch fish, and that's how they took care of the people. They loved the ocean, but there was someone else that they loved even more, and that someone else was their lord. Now, a Japanese lord is like a governor. He takes care of all the people that live in his land, and their governor lived high above them on a mountaintop that looked out over the ocean and the fishing village below. It was a beautiful house that he lived in, enormous mansion, ornately carved with wood. It had a red tile roof, and there were dragons carved all around the edges of it. It was painted green, but all the dragons were painted gold. It was beautiful. All around the house, there were fields full of crops. That's how he took care of his people. He fed them. He was very old. He was very kind. He was very wise. And for that reason, the people had a nickname for him. They called him Grandfather. And their grandfather lived in his house with his grandson. One day his grandson was playing with some toys in the garden when he happened to look out over the edge of the cliff out into the ocean, and he saw something he didn't recognize. He saw something that scared him. He saw a wave. Yeah, I know, there are millions of waves in the ocean, but this wave was tall, and this wave was wide. And this wave was moving faster than any wave the little boy had ever seen. And so he ran back to the house, he grabbed the old man by his sleeve, he dragged him to the edge of the cliff, he pointed out into the ocean, and as soon as the old man lifted up his head, he knew what he was seeing. Because you see, when he was a little boy, his grandparents told him the legends of a wave that comes every 100 years, a wave 100 feet tall, a wave that will destroy everything in its path. The old man knew what he had to do. He called his servants to him. He gave them each a torch. He said, take your torches, go to my lower fields, set my lower fields on fire. But master, they said, if we do that, then we won't have enough food to eat this year. Just do as I say, and do it quickly, said the old man. So the servants went out, and row by row by row, they set those crops on fire. soon, an enormous cloud of white smoke began to rise up high into the air above the mountaintop. And the old man did something weird. The old man went to the edge of the cliff. He bent down slowly, and he looked into the fishing village below. What he was trying to see, nobody knew. He must not have seen what he wanted to see, because he stood again. He called his servants to him. He said, "Take your torches, go to my upper fields, set my upper fields on fire." "But master," they said, "if we do that, then we won't have any food. Just do as I say." "And do it quickly," said the old man. So the servants went up, and row by row by row, they set those crops on fire as well. And soon another enormous cloud of white smoke began to rise up high into the air. It met that first cloud in the middle, and you could see the fires reflected off those clouds of smoke, all reds and yellows and oranges. The old man went to the edge of the cliff. And he still didn't see what he wanted to see. So he called his servants to him again. He said, "Take your torches, go to my house, set my house on fire." "And master," they said, "if we do that, then you won't have anything. Just do as I say. Do it quickly," said the old man. So the servants each took a corner of that beautiful old house, and they set it on fire. And because it was carved of really old dry wood, the flames shot up into the air. And the smoke that came off that fire was thick and gray and dark. If you were to step back from that mountaintop, you would have thought you were looking at a volcano by the looks of things. The old man went to the edge of the cliff. He bent down slowly. And he finally saw what he wanted to see. He saw people. People opening up their windows and their shutters and their doors. People putting up the side of the mountain with all the flame and the smoke. People rushing out of their houses carrying buckets or anything that would get some water up the side of that mountain. Behind them came small kids, your age, and they were carrying flower pots or pans, anything to get water up the side of that mountain. And then came the teenagers and the old folks, the grandpas, the grandmas, the aunts and uncles, until all 300 people who lived in that fishing village were making their way up the side of that mountain. And that's when that wave hit that fishing village below. They said it was like thunder. It was like the hoofbeats of 1,000 horses. It was like cannon fires. That wave grabbed that little fishing village and dragged it out into the ocean. People got to the top of the mountain, and what they found was nothing. Everything was burned. There were just wisps of dark smoke rising into the air. They turned to their grandfather. They turned to their lord, and they said, "Why would you do this? Now you're as poor as we are." And the old man lifted up his head and he said, "As much as I care for the things I own, I care even more for my friends." The villagers made their way down the side of the mountain again, and over time they rebuilt their own fishing village. They even tried to rebuild the old man's house, but it was never as magnificent as it had once been. And to this very day, anyone in this room can go to Japan. My little village is still there. In the center of that village is a little shrine. And on that shrine are these words: "To our grandfather, to our lord, who gave up everything that he had to save his people away." Guys, thank you so much for being here tonight. My name is Tim Hartman. If any of you would like to, you can find me on Facebook under Tim Hartman Storyteller, Assembly Performer. And, you know, go on my page, say hello, and look at my silly videos and my stupid face. And later this year, look for it. I'm coming out with a new CD of a story called Joe Mazurak, Man of Steel, which is the Tall Tale of Pittsburgh. So thank you so much for having me here today.
Thank you. You're very
welcome. Hello, Michael Clark. How are you? This is a great reverb.
This room has a wonderful reverb.
Okay. My name is Mr. World from Mad Science. We're going to do some pretty strange science things. I'm going to ask the lights. Do they good? Oh, do they good? things change. Physicists deal with how things move. Chemists deal with how molecules react. Geologists deal with the massive amounts of time it takes a rock to form. All of them deal with change. And they also deal, science also deals with subject matters that are that are on different scales. Some of what scientists study are very, very small, and some of what scientists study are very large. Scientists study atoms and the things that make up atoms and the molecules that atoms make up, which are incredibly small, and scientists also study stars, which are enormous. So we're going to look a little bit at scale right now, and a few other things. I have a little wire next to a button, and when I press the button, there's a spark at the end of the wire, it jumps across the wire, and when I press it, you can see it's a little blue spark. If I go into the light, you want to see it, but you can see a tiny little blue spark, just a tiny little blue spark. You see that? If I hold it close to me, okay, look at it again. How about down in the shadow? Do you see it? It's tiny. You couldn't. Okay, hold on. I'll do it one more time. Look here. Look at the tip of the wire. See it? Okay. Is it easier to see this?
Yeah.
This is what I'm talking about. Scale. Scientists study really small things like this little tiny spark, and also, you know, bigger things. Like that. I'm going to take a tiny canister. This is actually a film canister. It's an antique. You don't find these anymore. They're like, they used to be, you could go into any drugstore or whatever. I'm going to put a little bit of my fluid in. I'm actually going to try and put 3 drops. My pet's acting up.
Evaporation.
So the fluid in here is going to evaporate. evaporate. Evaporation is this. Think about this for a second. When it rains, and you get a puddle on the street, and you're walking along the street, what do you do when you get to a puddle on the street? Yeah, what do you do? What do? You shove it. You shove it, exactly. You splash it. That's what you should always do with puddles. Never stop. And then the next day, you're walking along and you're thinking to yourself, oh goody, there's a puddle. My mom yelled at me last night for shoes, my shoes. I'm going to jump in that puddle again. But something happened to the puddle. It evaporated. The molecules of water that were in that puddle are in constant motion. It's very dynamic. It looks like very placid and still, but it's incredibly dynamic. The molecules jump up out of the puddle and fall back down, and jump up and fall back down, and jump up and fall back down, and jump up and fall back down. Literally 10,000 times a second until they break free that little chemical bond, little bond that keeps them together, and it becomes a gas instead of a fluid. It's a very, very dynamic thing that occurs. And it occurs constantly. It occurs on lakes, it occurs on oceans, it occurs on puddles, and rivers, and cups of water left on kitchen sinks. Evaporation is a really, really remarkable thing. It is a phase shift. It's what scientists call a phase shift. You're changing, you're not actually changing the substance itself, it's a change in the phase and how it appears. It's no longer a liquid, it's a gas. And you can actually change that phase back again. So now I've allowed for a little bit of heat, which is just the movement of molecules as well, to evaporate my fluid. Excellent. Bethel Park. If I hit your home, you get a prize. Yeah, it's where you travel to. That'd be fine. Oh, prize. It's an Antarctica. Okay, one more. What I want you to do when I do this is watch the way the arm works. You have this downward motion with the weight allowing the tennis ball to fly off. So watch it one more time. Gravity's not strong enough to push your foot down. Gravity's really weak. Well, it's not weak, but we don't. I'll talk about that in a minute. When I start the college physics part, here we go. I'm going to hit the first ward of Bethel Park. No, I'm not. What I want you to tell me is the difference. You remember where the first tennis ball ended up when it was just one? Tell me the difference now.
It's gonna go far.
It's gonna go what?
Far. Really cold.
So if I put twice the tennis ball on, it'll go twice as far?
Yeah.
Oh, we have to talk. We have to talk.
Yes.
Wait a minute, I'm holding the label. dioxide on there. So wait a minute.
Plastics, and you can see, but The neat thing about polyethylene alcohol is the molecules that make it up all line up in a long chain. It's kind of like a train or a conga line. I said conga line. Do you guys know what I'm talking about?
Three.